Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Redeemer. It's great to have you guys with us today. Just a couple brief things here at the beginning. If you need anything at all, Andrew Ross is out in the narthex and would love to help you find your way around our building or around the city or put an umbrella in your hands because you probably need one today. But Andrew Ross is out there, so if you need anything at all, step out there, please. This morning, we're going to be continuing our series on true spirituality, looking at the book of 1 Corinthians. This morning, our pastor, Sean Slate, is going to be preaching for us on resurrection creation. So with that, would you please rise for the call to worship from 1 Peter 1:3. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Christ the Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Confess our faith together this morning using the Apostles' Creed printed in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Death and resurrection, Jesus has reconciled us to our Heavenly Father. So please join me in our communal confession of sin as we draw near to our Heavenly Father, confessing our sin and confessing our need for Him. Let's pray this prayer together. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the tomb, you have given us the sure sign of your power to deliver us from sin and death, and to renew your whole creation. We confess that we still fall into doubt and fear. We continue to cling to selfish ways and doubt your power to make all things new. Forgive our lack of faith. Have mercy on our weakness. Raise us from the death of sin, that we may live with Christ in the joy of his resurrection, now and forever. Amen. Let's spend a few moments in silent confession.
many sins because of your great mercy, because of the sacrifice of your Son, our Savior, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Would you hear the good news of the gospel from 1 Corinthians 15? Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Christians, I declare to you the forgiveness of your sins. In Jesus' name, therefore, would you please rise? Because he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
The maker of heaven and earth.
O Lord, open our lips,
and our mouth will show forth your praise.
Of Christ be always with you.
Also with you.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Good morning. My name is Karen Enns, and I am on staff here at Redeemer. And at this point in the service, we want to pause to highlight a few of the many announcements that are in your news and notes at the back of your bulletin about a couple different things that are going on in the life of our church. First, we want to thank you for your generous support to our common mission here in Urban and University Knoxville. Please continue to support this mission by placing your regular tithes and offerings in the offering boxes that are at the exits of the sanctuary and the narthex, by giving online, or by giving via Venmo. As of April 27th, we are running about 82% of the projected tithes and offerings to date. Second, today is May 1st. Congratulations, you made it to the one service. And First Sunday means two things here at Redeemer. First, it means First Sunday offering. And this Sunday, we're going to be helping our friends at Maynard Elementary with their teacher appreciation and fifth grade celebrations. So if you want to give a financial gift, you can place it in the offering boxes in front of the communion tables. We are also writing notes to Maynard's fifth grade graduates. If you would like to write a note, you can see Connie in the narthex after the service. And also, first Sunday of the month means first fruits, which means we're going to have Freezy Pops, hopefully not in the rain. We'll be outside if it is not raining, and we'll be in the chapel if it is raining. This Thursday is May 5th. But in the life of Redeemer, for women age, college age, and above, it's not Cinco de Mayo, it's Cinco de Madre. And all women, college age and above, are invited. We'll be meeting at Jennifer Slate's house at 6:30 p.m. We're going to have a taco bar and drinks. Theme wear related to mothers is preferred but not required. You can get some inspiration in the bulletin. And the cost is $5, and we ask that you RSVP so we can have appropriate food quantities. If you have any questions, you can see me after the service. I'll be up here. Tonight is going to start our new Sunday formation group that will meet for the first four Sundays in May. It's at 4 p.m., and it's going to be the Christ the Redeemer class that is going through the New City Catechisms. Child care is available, and Thrive and Middle School are meeting at that same time. Now, next Sunday is May 8th, and please make plans to join us after the service for a town hall. We're going to be all hearing very important updates on the Cultivate the Corner campaign that we have been talking about and supporting for the last couple years. And then finally, the last announcement that I'm going to highlight for you is twofold. It's an update on the Ordinary Time Prayers of the People installation, and there are two ways that you can help us. One, you can write a prayer on just ordinary printer paper, and you can place them in the baskets that we'll have up also next Sunday. We need these prayers by May 8th, which is next Sunday. The second part of this announcement is we need help folding the prayers. We're going to fold them into paper doves. They're going to be installed behind us, so our prayers will be up on the stage. And there is going to be a folding party, per se, on Tuesday, May 10th. At 6:30 p.m. in the chapel. You can contact Ben if you want to attend the folding party, and his email is in the bulletin. Now, will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, you are good and beautiful, and we thank you that we may gather together today. Lord, we look to you, for you are the Almighty King. You are our ever-present help in times of need. You are our shepherd and our provider, our mighty counselor and friend. Would you tend to your people? Provide work for those seeking jobs. Be a friend to the lonely. Heal the sick. Protect the vulnerable. And restore hope to the downcast and grant peace to the anxious. Be with students as this semester is winding down. Help them to finish strong. Grant them recollection of knowledge as they complete final projects and prepare for final exams. We pray that you would grant us curiosity about your word, that we would delight to read the story you've been writing since the beginning of everything. We pray that reading your word wouldn't result in the swelling of our own pride or self-righteousness, but reading your word would transform us more into the likeness of Christ, that we would be more repentant, hopeful, and worshipful. Grant us patience, delight, and wisdom as we learn to love you and love one another. Grant peace and unity among us, in our city, country, and world. Lamentations tells us that because of your faithful love, we do not perish. Your mercies never end, and they are new each morning. Great is your faithfulness, Lord. You are our portion. Therefore, we put our hope in you. We thank you that we continue celebrating the season of Easter and remembering that you are King over all. You're the King of peace, and that you promise to restore us to yourself. We ask that you would become more beautiful to us, and we bind these prayers together with the prayer you taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. At this time, our children ages 4 years through second grade are dismissed to children's worship. And as they go, please join me in singing Holy Spirit, Living Breath of God as we just prepare for the reading and the preaching of God's word. Let's sing this together.
If you have a Bible and you'd like to follow along with me, you can do so by turning to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to be looking this morning at verses 20 through 28 and then 45 through 49. You can follow along with me in the Bible that's provided in front of you or on your phone or in the bulletin where it's free. You can just follow along if you'd like to do that. I do want to thank you for being here. I want to say I know it's hot. we should have turned down the air earlier, and so I know it feels like we're stuck in an escape room with a bunch of junior high boys, but it's okay. We'll be all right. And so thank you. If you need anything, people are out in the foyer. They'd love to help you get you a moist towelette or something like that. My name's Sean Slade. I'm the pastor here, and we're really glad you're here with us this morning. Thank you for being with us. We know that there are a million different things that you could be doing this morning. For instance, you could be stuck in an elevator at the Sun Sphere, like most people who try to go up, or you could be working on your kickflips on your skateboard after having watched the Tony Hawk documentary on the internet, or you could be stretching those sore muscles, men, after that hard kickball game that we played over the weekend. But you're not doing any of those things. You're here with us this morning, and we are really glad to have you with us. And the reality is that there really is nothing better that you could do with your time than worship Jesus and consider his claims upon your life, to think about the beauty of his kingdom and the power of his resurrection. And so I do want to thank you for joining us. Welcome to Redeemer. What is Redeemer? Well, Redeemer's a church. And what that means is that we're a community of people who are trying to learn how to love God, and we're trying to learn how to love our neighbor. And fundamentally, what we believe is that Jesus is God. He's the Messiah. And he's entered into the world to die for our sins and to reveal the love of the Father. And so every week as his people, we gather together in his name to worship him so that we might learn to rest in the love that God has for us in Jesus. And as we rest in his love, we then become a people who delight to gather together in community. And so we love to get together and get stuck in the Sun Sphere and do kickflips and whatever tail spins on our skateboards together. But we really love to read the Bible and pray together so that we can remind each other of the great love that God has for us in Jesus. And so as we rest in his love and as we remind each other of his love, we then become a people who delight to gather together in service so that together we might reflect the love of God to our family, to our friends, to our neighbors who are here in Urban and University Knoxville, and hopefully in some way it would spill out into the entire earth, right? That's who we are. People who are trying to learn how to love God, trying to learn how to love our neighbor as we rest, as we remind, and as we reflect. And so to help us do that, we've returned to our series on 1 Corinthians, and we're looking at 1 Corinthians 15 during Eastertide. You might remember if you were with us during Lent, we went through the sayings of the cross, and we wanted to spend the season of Lent reflecting on the significance of the cross, right? What was the cross all about? What was Jesus doing? What we want to do during Eastertide is we want to reflect upon the resurrection and think about its significance for our lives. And so with that in mind, let's consider resurrection and new creation. And so let's look together, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're going to be looking at verses 20 through 28, and then 45 through 49. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father after destroying every rule and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death, for God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when he says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that he is excepted who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. Thus it is written, the first Adam became a living being. The last Adam became a living spirit. But it is not the spiritual that is first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Would you pray with me now for the teaching? Heavenly Father, we are thankful that you are a God who is not hidden nor silent, but one who delights to reveal himself to those whom he loves. And it's our prayer this morning that as we attend unto your word, that in your kindness and in your mercy, you would attend unto us, that we might see lovely and beautiful things here in your word. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, every year since 1927, Time Magazine has declared the person of the year, right? In 1927, Charles Lindbergh was celebrated for his transatlantic flight. In 1930, Gandhi was celebrated for being the leader of Indian independence. 1936, they celebrated Wallace Simpson and her love for the king that moved him to abdicate his throne and in order to marry her. In 1938, they celebrated Hitler. A little too soon. It's always too soon. 1939, they celebrated Stalin. Two bad years. 1947, they celebrated George Marshall as an architect of the Marshall Plan. 1962, Pope John Paul and Vatican II. 1963, they celebrated Martin Luther King Jr. and his I Have a Dream speech. 1968, they celebrated the crew of Apollo 8 for its orbit of the moon. 1972, they made a huge mistake. They should have celebrated the birth of Sean Slate, but they didn't. 1991, they celebrated Ted Turner and CNN. 1999, they celebrated Jeff Bezos for Amazon. 2010, they celebrated Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook. 2013, Pope Francis. And last year, they celebrated Elon Musk. And of course, this is just a random selection of people that I've pulled out from here. But some of them, as you listen to those names, they did amazing things. And some of them, as you know, did horrible things. Some of them are people you might never have heard of, and some of them are people you'll never forget. And the reason that I bring this up is because we all recognize that certain people have tremendous impact and influence for good and evil in the world. And it seems to me that we all have this desire to set apart representatives that help us make sense of the world in which we live. And so Time Magazine sets apart a representative, for this was what the world was like during this year. And this was the point of Time Magazine's Person of the Year, and this is also what the Bible does. But instead of picking and setting apart a bunch of different people every other year, the Bible tells us that there are two men who have impacted everything about you. There are two men who will determine your life, your death, and what is to come. And who are those two men? They are Adam and they are Jesus. They are Adam and they are Jesus. The grand narrative of the Bible tells us that we are either in Adam or we are in Jesus. I want you to look at the way Paul talks about this in verse 21. He says, "For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ shall all be made alive." And then look down at verse 45. "Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit." Look at verse 47. "The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven." Look at verse 49. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven." And so here's the point. We are either in Adam or we are in Christ, right? We're either in Adam or we are in Christ. And that's what I want us to think about this morning, these two points, right? In Adam or in Christ. Point one is going to be in Adam. Point two is going to be in Christ. So we have two points. We'll begin with point one, then we'll move on to point two. We'll start at point one, in Adam. Now, to understand this text, thank you, Jackson. To understand this text, it's very important for us to remember the story of the Bible. And the Bible begins like all good stories begin. It begins in the beginning. And in the beginning, God made the heavens and the earth, and everything that God made was good. In fact, it was very good. And he created this beautiful garden, and there from the dust of the ground, there from the dirt of the garden, he formed and he sculpted a man from the dust of the ground. And he made that man after his own image. And then by his grace, he breathed life into that man. And he placed Adam there in the center of the garden to work the garden, to tend the garden, to care for the garden, to care for everything that God had made. And Adam was placed in the garden then to shape and cultivate this garden, to bring out the potential of the earth. And he was then supposed to multiply and fill the earth. And he was supposed to care for the garden in such a way that the boundaries of that garden would expand and they would grow and eventually they would fill the entire earth. And this is what theologians call the cultural mandate, right? That man was made in the image of God to be fruitful and to multiply, to fill the world with God's image, to tend and to shape the garden for the building up of God's kingdom. And what's really interesting is that as you read the story, lots of things are multiplying and lots of things are filling, but only humanity is told to multiply and to fill. Only humanity is told to be fruitful and to multiply and to fill the earth. And all the other creatures, they just do it, right? The birds and the bees, they do it. The trees and the plants, they produce more trees and plants. The fish of the sea produce more fish of the sea. The rabbits produce more rabbits. But humanity is told to multiply and to fill, to be fruitful and to fill the earth. And this seems to imply that God is inviting humanity to be thoughtful and to be intentional about our fruitfulness and our filling. He wants us to be a people who think about what we make and what we do. Because when human beings multiply and fill the earth, think about what we do. We create families, and we create neighborhoods, and we create communities, and we create cities, and we create music, and we create art, and we create buildings, and we fill the earth with lots and lots and lots of stuff. And as we do this, we then make societies, and we make nations and cultures. And these societies and nations and cultures, they go on to shape and fill the earth. And so what actually happens is that when we fill and when we multiply and when we make and when we do, that impacts the world. And it not only impacts like the world in a vague way, it also it impacts the earth itself. And it impacts sort of the cultures in which we live, and it shapes not only our present moment, but it actually shapes then succeeding generations. And the idea that comes out of Genesis is this: as Adam goes, so goes the world. Like as Adam goes, so goes the world. You may have heard of the New England Primer. The New England Primer was sort of this old book put out by American Puritans back in the 1700s. And it was a way to sort of teach children grammar and to teach children the ABCs, and it had a little bit of catechism written into it. And with each letter, it had a little different, had a different little jingle. And the jingle for A was this: Adam's fall, we send all. Right? Adam's fall, we send all. As Adam, all right, so us. And that's Paul's point, verse 21. For as by a man came death, verse 22, for as in Adam all die. And then look at verse 48. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And the point is this, that Adam is our representative. Now, as American Christians, we might not like this because we want to be a people who stand on our own two feet. We think that we were born sort of immune to the works of the past. But when God made us, he did not make us merely as individuals. He made us as a people who are connected to one another, connected throughout time and space. He made us as a people who are connected in life and in death to Adam and to all his posterity. Right? And that's how life actually works. It works through representation. Even in America, I mean, think about it. Here in America, we elect officials to represent us. And those representatives, they then go off and they make laws that impact us. And they pass taxes that impact us. And if our representatives tells us to pay taxes or passes a law for us to pay taxes, we pay more taxes. If they send us off to war, we go to war. If they send out stimulus checks, we get stimmies, right? And then we, like, some of us love that, and some of us hate that. And what our representatives do affects all of us, like on a local level, on a national level, and even on a global level. Because is it not true that we are held morally responsible by the world for the actions of our representatives? Or just think about the way we talk about our beloved Vols. We talk about how we destroyed Auburn on Friday night. And then we were disappointed last night as Auburn came back and defeated us, right? Our lives are bound up, right, with the glory of the Vols. Or we think about our children, right? People, I mean, whether you like it or not, people relate to our children in light of us. And whether you like it or not, our children are impacted by our particular successes and our particular failures, by our joys and by all of our neuroses. And it impacts them for the rest of their lives. And this is how we relate to God as well. We either stand before God in the polluted stream of Adam and all of his posterity, or we stand before God in the renewing, refreshing, life-giving spirit of the resurrected Jesus, right? And wherever we are, in whomever we are, right, determines your faith. And it shapes your life and who you will become. And sadly, when Adam turned away from God to live for himself, there was this rip that was sort of torn in the fabric of the world. Right, Adam was placed in the garden to bear fruit, to bear the fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, goodness, self-control, and all of these things. But when he turned away from God, he began to bear the fruit of death and of darkness. I don't know if any of you are like me, but I'm really excited about Stranger Things season 4 coming out later this month. And if you're like me, maybe you've been rewatching the previous seasons to get prepared and to get brought back up to speed. And if you remember, in Stranger Things, there's this rip in the fabric of the world, and they've got to seal it up. And they've got to seal up that rip that's in the fabric of the world, because on the other side of the rip, right, is the upside down. And the upside down is this world that mirrors our world, but it's our world in grayscale. It's this world that isn't filled with life, but it's actually filled with death and darkness and dust and decay and detritus. It's just raining down all the time upon everything. And the upside down is the normal world, but it's the normal world dying. Right? It's the normal world dying. And what happens, you know, is the death of the upside down is running through that rip. It's running through that rip in the fabric of the world, and it is intruding upon life. And that's what happened, right, when Adam sinned against God, right? The upside down, like, enters into the goodness of creation. And like Will Byer, who had entered into the upside down, and then he swallows part of the upside down. And when he swallows part of the upside down, it becomes a part of him. Well, Adam had swallowed a part of the upside down. And it twisted him, and it became a part of his life. And when it became a part of his life, and as we've dwelled in the upside down with him, it's become a part of our life, and it begins to twist us, and we bear the fruit of the upside down as well. And this is why we die. Now, we might not understand the metaphysics of this. We might not like the DNA of this. We might not understand the DNA of this, but that's not really the point. This is the way things are. Right? This is what God has done, and we know it because this is what we experience. We have all experienced the impact of Adam, and therefore we all die, we all fear death, and we all participate in it. I was talking with a good friend of mine this week. His father just passed away, and he said that as he's been thinking about his father, there's this old Dan Fogelberg song that just keeps running on repeat in his mind, and it's that Leader of the Band song, and it goes like this. The leader of the band is tired, and his eyes are growing old. He's tired, and his eyes are growing old. And isn't that one of the horrible things about the life of Adam, the life that Adam has left to us, that our bodies become tired and our eyes, they grow old. That voice that used to like boom out with such vibrancy begins to grow weaker. Right, those strong arms that used to pick up the children when they fell become weak. Your back that used to help your friends move from apartment to apartment and house to house in your 20s and your 30s, like you can't do it anymore. Those legs that used to carry you so fast and so quickly, those taste buds that used to be sensitive have now become dull. These bodies are filled with aches and pains, right? That's our fate. And that's the fruit of Adam, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And that's what it means to be in Adam. We know it, we experience it, we're broken by it, we hate it. But the good news of what God has done is that there's another man. And that other man is not you. And it's not me, but that other man is Jesus. Look at verse 47. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust. The second man is from heaven. And what Paul wants us to see is that Jesus is the second Adam. He is the new man of a new creation. And therefore, if you are in Christ, you are a new creation. Right? And more specifically, we are the fruit of the new creation. Why don't you look at verse 20? But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. And when you think about this, the crucifixion, Jesus dies, he's buried, he's planted in the dust of the earth, and at the resurrection, he comes up bearing fruit. He comes up to live once again, and he is raised, the Bible tells us, as the first fruits of a new creation. He is raised up in the new garden as the new man, the new Adam, to tend that garden, to keep that garden, to be fruitful and to multiply within the garden, to shape the world according to the glory and the goodness of God. And by saying that Jesus is the first fruits, that means that he is first and there is more to come. He's saying that Jesus is the beginning and we are the fruit that will follow. And I want you to look at what Jesus then does for his people. Verse 21, for as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. Do you see what he's saying? He's saying, look, Adam brought death. Jesus has been resurrected to bring life out of that death, to restore that which has been lost. And then look at verse 22. For as in Adam, all die. And he's saying all who are in Adam, they die. And then so also in Christ shall all be made alive. All who are in Christ, though they die, will be given life. And this is amazing because what he's saying is we think about the impact of Adam and it seems so powerful and death seems to come for us all. And what he's saying is Christ is more powerful than Adam. That Christ has entered into the world to undo what Adam has done, to restore that which Adam has lost. And where Adam wilted and died, Jesus is buried and comes forth bringing forth fruit and life. And how does he do this? Verse 45, the first man, Adam, became a living being. And this is interesting. Adam didn't have his own life. He had a life that was given to him. And because his life was given to him, his life could be taken from him. And so when Adam turned away from the source of life, who was God, he died. Because God alone is the source of life. And when Adam died, we died in him. But that is not the case with Jesus. Look at verse 45. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. You see, Adam received life, but Jesus doesn't receive life. Jesus gives life. Jesus is the giver of life, and in him is life, and therefore death has no claim on him. He is life itself, and so all who look to Jesus for life, He gives it to them. And then notice verse 47. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust, meaning that Adam was created. Adam was not the creator. And what this means is that Adam is dependent. Adam was fashioned in such a way, he was formed from the dust by God to be dependent upon God, to live for God, but he was not God. And we are not God. And when we try to be God, we return to the dust from which we came. Not so with Jesus. Look at verse 47. The second man is from heaven. And this means that the man of heaven is the one who gave life to Adam in the first place. And he continues to be from heaven. And this is a big deal because the man of heaven must return not to the dust of the earth. The man of heaven must return to heaven itself. And because he is from heaven, he is not controlled or ruled or destined to the decay of the dust, but he is destined to life and to the giving of life itself. Now, here's what's amazing. Bear with me. An aside here. I was talking with my wife this week, and she said, Sean, whenever you say this is amazing, bear with me, it's usually not amazing. So anyway, this is amazing, bear with me. Right? Look at verse 48. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. And as is the man of heaven, so also are those who are of heaven. Just as we have borne the image of the man of dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven. This is amazing, because what he's saying is, if you are in Jesus, now to be in Jesus means, right, that the Spirit of God has worked faith in you to love him, to believe him, to trust him, to follow after him. If you are in Jesus, it's not just the good news that you get to go to heaven. Listen to this. He says, you are from heaven. Your origin is no longer of this earth. Your origin is from heaven itself. Because Jesus has given his Spirit to give you a new birth. And you have now been born of heaven. And as those who have been born of heaven, he says, we shall also not just go to heaven, but we shall bear the image of the man of heaven. That is amazing. We shall become like Jesus in every way. In the same way that our natural union with Adam, through our natural union with Adam, we're born, we image him, and we die. By our spiritual union with Jesus, we have been born, and we live, and we will be resurrected to bear his glorious image. And what this means is that the resurrection of Jesus has brought a new power into the world. And so think about it this way. We just talked about Stranger Things. And so at the fall, there was a rip in the fabric of the earth that let the upside down in. And the death and the decay of the upside down have come in and tried to claim and rule all things. But at the resurrection, a new rip has happened. At the resurrection, God, right, Jesus, has opened the gates of heaven. And he's come back to give life. And he's come back to subdue all of the upside down and make the upside down right side up again. Look at what it says in verse 26. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For God has put what? All things in subjection under his feet. When all things are subjected, verse 28, then God may be all in all. All things. What's amazing is that at the resurrection, Jesus is opening the gates of heaven and he's pulling heaven to earth. At the resurrection, the future is beginning to flood into the present. And by the power of the resurrection, God is making all things new. All things new. And that includes you and me. And that by the power of the resurrection, God is now reforming us and refashioning us after the image of Jesus. And he's remaking us. And he's remaking us not from the ground up. He is making us from heaven down to bear the image of the man of heaven, to change us from one degree to another in order that we might be more fully conformed to the image of Jesus. And on that final day, on that day of resurrection, we too will be raised up like Jesus from the dust of Adam to bear the image of our beloved elder brother. Look, if you are in Christ, if the Spirit of God dwells within you now, that means that the resurrection power of God is at work as well. And so how do you see the power of the resurrection at work in your life today? Do you see him beginning to change you? Not change you from one degree to the next degree, to the next degree. Do you see this God, this man of heaven, the one who is patient, working patience in you? Do you see this man from heaven who is loving, working his love into you? Do you see this man of heaven who is wise, working his wisdom into you? Do you see him conforming you more and more, little by little, degree by degree, by the power of the resurrection to be made more like him? You see, the resurrection is the power of God opening the gate so that the man of heaven might come in, so that God might begin to fill all in all. And here's what's amazing. We are the fruit of that new creation. And we have been given new life. We have been born again by God himself so that we might bear the image, so that we might begin to fill the earth, so that we might begin to bear the fruit of heaven here on earth just as it is in heaven. And that, again, is the point of this table. The man of heaven has come down. And as he came down, he took on a body. He took on the body of the man of the earth. And he suffered and died like all men and women of the earth. But as the man of heaven, he is the Lord and giver of life. And the dust of the earth cannot hold him, and so he rose. He rose from the dust to be fruitful and to multiply, to fill the earth with the glorious fruit of heaven, to fill the earth with a new humanity, a humanity not born of flesh and blood, but a humanity born by the Spirit of God and fed not with the bread of this earth, but with the bread and wine of heaven. And that's what this table is. It is the life of God come down from heaven to feed us. To feed us with himself. And we will feed upon him week after week after week, strengthened, conformed by his mercy, until the glorious day when we are raised up to bear his glorious image. Therefore, now I invite you to rise and to lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is good and right to do so.
It is very good and right that we should at all times and all places give thanks to you, O Holy Lord, Father Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the Passover Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we praise and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you, singing.
Holy,
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 holy Lord.
Holy,
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 holy God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory.
Blessed.
Blessed.
Hosanna in the
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are thankful that you have come down to feed us with yourself so that you might conform us to you. Would you continue that good work, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood poured out for the remission of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." And therefore, we break bread in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and we declare the great mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
These are the gifts of God, and they're for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will the servers please come forward? And as they come forward, just a few notes of instruction. The ushers are going to release you from your rows. We're going to ask you to exit to the east. You'll come up to the table. We'll gather around in a circle. The server will feed you with the bread, and then with the wine, you'll go back to your seats to the west. And then the next group will come up and we'll continue until all have been served. If you need to be served, please let one of the ushers know if you're not able to make it up front, and we'd love to bring the elements to you. Come for the feast is spread. Thank you.
Now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us.
Stand and sing our final hymn for all the saints.
reigns triumphant, rising bright array, the King of glory passes on his way. Alleluia, alleluia. From earth's wide bounds, from ocean's farthest coast, through gates of pearl, streams in the countless host, singing to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here.
Just a reminder, today is First Fruits, and so we have Freezy Pops out in the parking lot. It doesn't look like it's raining, so we'd love for you to join us in fellowship and hang out if you're able to do that. Would you please stretch forth your hands and receive the Lord's blessing? Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you might do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Thanks be to God.